He was in constant danger. If you look at Acts 19, you'll see the whole city was in uproar because he was preaching the gospel and they were opposed to it, at least many of them. And others who were opposed to it stirred up the people. Acts 19:23-41. But when you look at the text, you see that out of all that difficulty, the Apostle Paul wrote that he intended to remain in Ephesus for a while. And notice what he said. For a great door and effectual is open unto me, and there are many adversaries. 1 Corinthians 16:9. Quite often, our best opportunities are the outgrowth of difficulties. In the work of Paul and Barnabas, when they first preached the gospel of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, Acts 13:14, if you know closely, they were run out of every city because they preached the gospel there. Yet when they returned to the church, that is the church in Antioch, it was to recount, and here's what he said, how God had opened the door of faith unto the Gentiles, Acts 14:27. There was recognition on the apostle's part that the Lord gave him great opportunity to sound out the gospel of Christ. In 2 Corinthians 2 and verse 12, he wrote, a door was opened unto me in the Lord. Then when he asked brethren to pray for him, it was that God may open unto us a door for the word. Colossians 4 and verse 3. I'm going to pause here and just simply say in this narration, he had a complete different outlook on life than most of us do. We understand why he was able to do so much for the Lord when we understand his disposition of mind. He had a view toward difficulties that we just don't have when it comes right down to it. You know, I think that I'm a plague on anything having to do with this PA system or anything else. Many of the parables Jesus told are designed to teach us opportunities, about opportunities that God gives us. It's just sometimes we don't know what an opportunity is. We don't know how to recognize it. Because we think of opportunities when everything is just moving smooth. It's all going like we want it. There's no problem. I can tell you this much, Paul did not view opportunities coming solely from that way. God gives us many opportunities. What Jesus said to the church in Philadelphia in Revelation chapter 3 and verse 8 is typical of his opportunities for us. Behold, I've set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. We would do well, first of all, in our individual lives, then family life and neighbors round about us. Whoever it is we work for and work with, at school or whatever, as the church collectively, we would do well to ask what doors are open to us. And look for them not from the standpoint of somebody saying, come on in, I'm ready to study the Bible with you. But look at situations with people as Paul looked at them. And we'll see things maybe differently than usual. Christ expects us to use our talent of opportunity, if you please, not to bury it, Matthew 25:14-30. But if we're going to walk through the door the Lord opens, there are some qualities that we need to develop. First of all, we need vision. We need vision to see those particular opportunities. Solomon wrote in Proverbs 29:18, where there is no vision, the people perish. I think we have it down pretty good from Hosea. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, but here I'm seeing that people perish for lack of vision. Which means we don't see things as God intends us to see them. Although this is often used to show that leaders need vision, and they do, the context does not limit it just to the leaders. We all need the vision to see what we're talking about today, and that is the open doors to spread the gospel. It's written of Moses in Hebrews 11:27. He endured as seeing him who is invisible. And maybe that's the solution for us in seeing the opportunities. We need to look to God. For when we depend on God according to his word, when we seek his will and his strength, then there will be doors open to us that will not be open to us if we don't do that. Someone has said one reason we miss so many opportunities is that they come disguised as trouble. Now you think about what we read earlier. Well, I think that's pretty true. If Paul had looked at all the trouble that came upon him in the way most of us do, he would not have seen open doors. He would not have seen opportunities. There's much truth in this. When a friend suffers in sickness or death of a loved one, there's an opportunity for us. Remember, we're to do good unto all men, especially those household of faith, Galatians 6:10. Remember, too, that a word fitly spoken is like apples of gold and pictures of silver, Proverbs 25:11. Those words have meanings, and thus they teach us a lesson. All too often we allow open doors to close because we feel there's no mistake made by our silence. Think about that a minute. So often we've got an opportunity, but we just won't speak up. There's a time for silence and there's a time to speak, Ecclesiastes 3:7. Maybe we need to pray for wisdom to be able to know when we ought to do one and leave the other one undone, but nevertheless, it still says there's a time to speak, time to be silent. I want to know both times. Open doors to help needy people, to encourage the brethren, to tell the lost the gospel of Jesus Christ. These opportunities abound, even in our land. When we see all the trouble that we all recognize happening in the land, do we see it just as trouble, or do we see it as an opportunity for the church to shine? For us to speak the truth. We need to look to God who helps us see those problems and the open doors that they have for us. Another point, besides needing vision to see the open doors, we must live by faith to conquer. Well, you say, what's new about that? Well, remember, the simplest definition of faith is taking God at his word. And it means then we put the word in action. So obedience is nothing but faith in action. God spoke to Paul at Corinth, and here's what he said in Acts 18:9. Be not afraid, but speak and hold not thy peace, for I am with thee, and no man will set on thee to harm thee. Now I know that Paul, having the ambassadorial powers of the baptismal measure of the Holy Spirit, thus is being given supernatural insight in situations and specifically what was going on right then. And I know we don't have that. But we have God with us. As we keep his commandments, he's with us. And besides that, we should have been vaccinated with the truth that tells us we have a cross to bear and that God expects us in preaching the gospel and in contending for the faith and living daily our Christian lives to be persecuted, to deal with it. It's a part of life if you're faithful to God. It was this assurance of faith that enabled the Apostle Paul to persevere, even under severe persecution. You know, God knows what we can stand and what we can't. He also knows the solution to all problems, and it's the Word of God. So when we see whatever it is that comes our way, then he expects us to be familiar with the Bible, that is, to have a knowledge of the Bible, to be able to face whatever it is. We have the assurance that he will not allow us to be tempted above that which we are able, but will, with the temptation, make a way of escape that we'll be able to bear it. Well, he's talking about whenever Satan, in whatever way he approaches us, lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, the pride of life, solicits us to transgress God's will, we're already assured that there's a way of escape. Of course, you have to know the book to see the way of escape. Now, if you notice up here in the front on both sides and in the back, there's a sign that says exit. We all know what exit means. It's a way of escape. There are three ways of escape that are officially designated. Now, there's some windows in these classrooms that if you got desperate, you could try to kick them out and go through. But we're talking about ways of escape built into the building. You say, well, there are also entrances. Okay, but it has exits. And that's the point. And you even have firewalls that says that there must be clearly marked exits. All of that's designed to help people. Designed to get them out of a bad situation or what could be a very bad situation. Well, what about being tested? Satan tempting us and trying to get us to violate God's law. There's a way of escape. The Lord says, I guarantee you there is. Well, then why don't we know about them? Well, all too often, we don't know our Bible like we ought to. Or we're too busy exercising our own human wisdom without leaning on the Bible and giving our own viewpoints of what ever happened rather than just have a scripture come to mind as to what deals with it. The Lord has legislated. The Lord's given us his mind. It's presented in the words that express his will. And this passage above my head here wouldn't make a bit of sense if he hadn't done that. But I'm expected to know it well enough to where it becomes almost second nature to me that when anything comes up, I start calling scripture. I start reminding myself, here's the approach. With the Egyptian army just behind, what was the situation with Israel as they sought to leave Egypt? Well, they were ready to give up. But Moses told them, be not afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, Exodus 14:13. Later in Hebrews 11:29, we read, by faith they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land. I'm sure it took a great deal of courage for them to launch out, as it were, into the Red Sea. And it takes courage on our part to achieve great things, as the Bible defines what's great, when it comes to serving the Lord faithfully today. But that's what we're expected to do. I can't shift my responsibility for doing such over to you, and you can't shift yours over to me. We can encourage each other in our daily walk of life to be sure we have a thus saith the Lord, and that we abide by it for all we believe and practice. But that's the way it's right and cannot be wrong. There's no doubts there. The great cry of triumph that Paul declared is a marvelous thing to look at in 1 Corinthians 15:57, where he says, thanks be to God who giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And then our victory in Christ is actually explained when you look at 1 John 5:4. He says, this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Well, I remind you, faith comes by hearing the Word of God. So there's not going to be any faith if we don't know the Bible. And yet it is our faith that overcomes the world. We will never use our open doors until we have the faith to use them. To live by faith, Romans 1, means more than simply believing that God exists. Simply assenting to the fact that he is. To live by faith means accepting God's word and living your life according to its teachings, putting your trust in what he's promised us, keeping his commandments. Then if God be for us, as Paul wrote, who can be against us? Romans 8:31. So it was this kind of faith that enabled Paul to write in Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. So Paul was able to walk through these doors of opportunity. The doors of opportunity that the Lord himself opened for him because the Lord was with him. And he could see them to be doors of opportunity and not something else. And we must remember that our Lord is with us today. Jesus promised to be with us as we went out to teach the gospel, Matthew 28:20, even as he was with all of his people at all times. You say, well, I don't know. I don't see him. Well, I don't see a lot of things, but they're there, even in this physical world. And we can take God at his word that he's with us. Another point is that we must be sacrificial in order to achieve. We must be willing to give up, first of all, our own lives to do with them as we please. We must make choices that put the kingdom first. There is cost. There, you might say, there's hazard in anything worth doing. The Good Samaritan risked his life and goods in what we would call bad man's territory or robber territory in order to help the man who had been robbed, Luke 10:33-37. Paul even speaks, or he writes, of those who hazarded their lives for the gospel in Philippians 2:30. And the apostles were in perils constantly because of their duty to God that they sought to perform, 2 Corinthians 11:23-28. All because of love of the Lord. And they love the souls of men lost in sin. When you look back through the Old Testament and you look to Abraham and to Moses, Gideon, Elijah, Daniel, so many others, we call them great heroes of faith. Well, they set before us the necessity of sacrifice. Now that's the way they had their open doors that they could see, and they had the courage then to sacrifice to do them, to take advantage of them, whatever they might be. God gave his son as a sacrifice for us, John 3:16. Jesus died for us so that we might live, not unto ourselves, but unto him who died for them, 2 Corinthians 5:14-15. It just simply comes down to this. Following the Lord faithfully costs us in time, in effort, in money, in hazards. It is foolish to try to teach people how to be saved and not mention these very things. As he set the price in Matthew 16:24, in Luke 14:33, if any man come after me, any man, let him deny himself. Now that's not easy. That is just not easy. And take up his cross and follow me. Then he that renounceth not all that he hath cannot be my disciple. Now let's understand this. This doesn't mean that as soon as you become a Christian, you go out and live in a mud hut. It doesn't mean that at all. But it does mean you will rather than compromise the truth. That disposition of heart must be there. It must be there. The open door the Lord gives us requires sacrifice. There's no way you can tell people you can go to heaven without sacrifice. When Romans 12:1-2 makes it clear that we live daily, our lives, our bodies are offered as a living sacrifice. We put our wants and desires and plans on hold, if such need be, to carry out His will. Christ died for us, and we die for Him. Colossians 3:3, Paul said to the church, "Therefore ye died, and your life is hid with Christ in God." How has that changed? And even if the cost sometimes seems high, remember, Paul wrote in Romans 8:18, "The sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed." Those things that we must give up that are important to the here and now and to our fleshly desires, if we would just learn to look at them as, what will they be worth on the day that I die? What will they be worth on the day the Lord returns? And yet we give so much time to those things, so much mental effort, so much planning, so much concern. But then, too, we must develop love to motivate us to be what God says we ought to be. We must have love as the Bible defines love. If we ask the Lord, what is the great and first commandment, do you think He's going to answer that question today differently than when He answered it almost 2,000 years ago? "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind and with all thy strength." Mark 12 and verse 30. And then I must ask, what prompts us to love God? Well, John gives us the answer in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 19. "We love Him because He first loved us." So as God's love caused Him to send Christ as a sacrifice for us, so isn't it just common sense to reason that our love causes us to live for Him, to abide by His will, to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness? And when then He opens a door of opportunity because we love Him, then we can walk through it because we'll see it. Jesus said, "If you love Me," American Standard Version, "ye will keep My commandments," John 14, 15. Then John, writing Christians in 1 John 5, verse 3, said, "This is the love of God. I often over the years have said, do you want to see the love of God?" Well, John says, this is the love of God. What is it, John? What is the love of God? It's very simple, that we keep His commandments. This has always bothered me ever since I was a young preacher, even before I was preaching well. And I kept hearing these people, virtually my age, talk about working one another up into some sort of emotional lather to be able to know you love God. I read this verse from old King James Bible. "If you love Me, you keep My commandments." And then, "This is the love of God." And I just asked myself the question, David, what is the love of God? And John, by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, answers that we keep His commandments. Now, you can't get plainer than that. If I love God, I'm going to do what He tells me. That is my necessary food. If you love God, we'll use the open doors that He provides. And I may not see them if I don't love God and keep His commandments. That same love will cause us to do whatever it is that we do His way and not our way. I really believe a great many members of the church are still struggling because they're trying to force things to be done their way. I know for a fact that there are a great many homes that are hurting because everybody's trying to make things be done, each one of them, their way, rather than be what the Bible says a husband ought to be, or a wife what a wife ought to be, or parents what parents ought to be. And there's roles in for children, according to the Bible. And then we sing the song, but the message doesn't seem to get over. Let Him have His way with thee. Well, I have a will. We all do. We're free moral agents. That means I control myself for what I'm going to do, what I'm not going to do. Now, I'm either going to submit to the Lord's will or I'm not. There's no other in between. I'll just knuckle down and render obedience to Him, as the old saying goes. I guess they still use that term, buddy, knuckle down. Or I'll do things my way. Love must be the true motivation for all that we do. And then you find this simply said in 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 14, I believe it is. Let all you do be done in love. You know, that tacks indirectly with this Colossians 3:17. It's not a matter of just doing commandments. It's not a matter of just memorizing scripture. It's a matter of loving Jesus Christ, of being devoted to Him, of being determined to please Him. So love will determine whether or not we do what the Lord tells us. Love will determine what our attitude is toward ourselves, toward our families, toward other people, toward the church. Love will decide whether or not we speak about Christ to the lost. The scripture says love suffers long and is kind, 1 Corinthians 13. We're also taught about going the second mile. Love does that, Matthew 5. You do what has to be done and you're willing to go further than that. A great many people aren't happy because they're just trying to do the bare essentials. So love will help us have the vision we need to see the doors which God opens. The faith to overcome the obstacles and walk through, the willingness to sacrifice in order to use whatever that open door is. What we need to do is to honestly and objectively, in the light of the truth of this sermon and others like it, to simply examine ourselves. Do I love God? Do I have faith in God? Do I see those open doors? Have I learned to look for them? Do I know that those open doors may come through a great trial in my life? Because they did with Paul. Notice that he said, as we noticed in the beginning, an effectual and great open door, or door is opened unto me. Did you notice the latter part of that? And there are many adversaries. That didn't seem to shake him up. I remember an older preacher who was noted for his debating and writing ability, saying that he just always learned to view the problems that arose in the church as opportunities to teach the truth. And that changed his whole viewpoint of dealing with problems. And I think we'll find that problems take on a different view when you look at it from the standpoint as opportunities to teach the truth, to reach souls, to defend the faith, to edify the church. Behold, I set before you an open door. If you're not a faithful child of God, or if you're needing to become a Christian, then now's a good time to do it because it's the only time you have. So if you need to correct things in your life, then now's the time to do that by becoming a Christian, being baptized into Christ, having first believed in Christ, repented of your sins, and confessed your faith in Him. And you and you alone, besides God and among humans, know what you need to correct in your life. It's done by repentance and confession of the sins and prayer to God for forgiveness. But it does mean there's been a radical change in your inward man and outlook on life when repentance takes place. So if you're subject to the invitation of Jesus Christ, we invite you to come to Him while we stand and sing.